This is Duke University Chapel.
Grace and peace to you in Jesus Christ, our Lord, and welcome today to this service of worship. We are celebrating Pentecost today. This is a very joyful day in the church calendar. It's known as the church's birthday. I'll spare you from hearing a rendition of Happy Birthday, however. I also wanted to offer a particular welcome to all of our visitors, especially those people who might be here today as part of Duke's Cancer Survivors Weekend. We're glad to have you with us, and we hope that this is a place where you might encounter God. We also remember our friends and members of the chapel's congregation, who many of whom this weekend have gathered at Camp Caraway for a congregation retreat. And this morning we have with us our soloist, Patricia Donnelly Phillips. Many of you will be familiar with Patty. She's a longtime member of the chapel choir, and for those of you who don't know her, you will soon discover that she is a real gift to our community. And speaking of choirs. The chapel's summer choir is set to begin in just 2 weeks. And all of you here today can be a part of it. You don't have to have any experience. All you have to do is come at 9:15 in the morning on Sundays and be prepared to sing. So you'd be welcome. If you have ever wanted to try your hand at singing in a choir, don't be intimidated. The time is now, or in 2 weeks, beginning in June. And now let us stand and offer our praises to God.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us surrender to the Spirit of truth as we confess our sins before God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ. Have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. May Almighty God forgive you of all of your sins, strengthen you in his goodness, and raise you to new life in Jesus Christ, and seal you forever by the fire of the Holy Spirit through Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let us now share the peace of Christ with one another.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Holy Spirit, sent by the Father, open your words to us and ignite in us your holy fire. Strengthen your children with the gift of faith. Revive your church with the breath of love. And renew the face of the earth through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The first lesson is from Acts, the second chapter. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like a rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now, there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language, Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They are filled with new wine.' But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days, it will be, declares God, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy, and I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. The gospel lesson is from John, the 14th chapter. Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact, will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please sit down. I wonder if you have a motto. The United States has a motto, "In God We Trust." The difference between a motto and a mission statement is that a mission statement commits an organization to do something, whereas a motto expresses a reality you believe to be true, whether you do anything about it or not. Andrew Carnegie had a motto: first honesty, then industry, then concentration. If you're fancy, you design a posh coat of arms and put a motto in Latin underneath, like "Eruditio et Religio" or "Arge Fac et Gaudeam," which, as I'm sure you don't need me to tell you, means go on, make my day. The church has a motto. It's tucked neatly into the Nicene Creed. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. Or una sancta catholica et apostolica, if you like your mottos in Latin. You can see every dimension of this motto displayed in the Pentecost story in Acts chapter 2, the moment we often call the birthday of the church. This tight-knit group of disciples surrounded by tongues of fire shows all four of these characteristics, sometimes known as the four marks of the church. We see the church as one when it says they were all together in one place. We see the church as holy when it says a tongue of fire rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit. We see the church as Catholic, in other words, as embracing what today we often call diversity, when it says there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem, and when the large crowd says, how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? And it goes without saying that we see the church as apostolic, because this moment is the sending out of the apostles that all subsequent mission looks to. One holy Catholic and apostolic. If only. It's just as well this is a motto and not a mission statement, because if it was a mission statement, we'd all be fired. I'm sure, like me, you've had experience of church being few or even none of these things. You've known a church that seemed united, but around trivia, around pettiness, around prejudice, around anxiety, around things that seemed far from the holy Catholic and apostolic gospel. You've seen congregations working hard at being one holy and Catholic, but endlessly deferring to subcommittees and reviews and reports and bureaucracy and losing all the simplicity and urgency of the first apostles. You've seen people dedicated to holiness and to faithfulness to the early church, but unable to be patient and understanding and remain one, or apparently incapable of embracing the diversity of the rainbow of God's nations. You've seen a church that seemed to flourish and embody the unity, diversity, and mission of the Acts of the Apostles, but where holiness was let down by human fragility and failure. And yet, you're here this morning. Funny that. You've seen the worst the church can be, but still you're here. I can only assume you must have a stubborn, pig-headed resilience, for which the only appropriate word is love. My guess is you're here this morning because you love the church. Sure, you know there's 100 things wrong with it, and you feel baffled and bewildered and bored and even betrayed by it, but you're still held by its mystery. Hold on to that word mystery for a moment. The Catholic philosopher Gabriel Marcel made a distinction between a problem and a mystery. A problem is something you can stand outside and walk around. It's something you can usually solve by technical skill. A broken window is a problem, but you can solve it by fixing a new one. Often a problem can be solved using a technique developed by somebody else. But a mystery you can't solve. A mystery you can't stand outside. You have to enter it. A mystery is something you can't just look at. Someone else's answer probably won't work for you. you have to discover your own. The church is a mystery and not a problem. Some may approach it as a problem and try to offer you a solution. There's countless conferences every year offering techniques of church growth or training in family systems theory. But there isn't a simple solution that solves it. And that's because it's a mystery. The church is the best idea anybody ever had. Dynamic unity, profound godliness, gregarious diversity, historic identity, you can't beat that. It's a fabulous combination, but it frequently becomes a monster or a mess. It's a real mystery. One author who describes this mess is the British novelist Rose Macaulay. She spent a lot of her life on the edge of the church, partly because of its mysteries and partly because of her own. Her semi-autobiographical novel, The Towers of Trebizond, describes a journey around the Middle East in the 1950s. In it, she tells the story of a woman named Laurie, caught between the eccentricity of the characters she meets and her own irreconcilable loves. All the while, Laurie is wrestling with the absurdity of the church. Her Middle Eastern travels bring Laurie to Bethlehem. And while in that little town of poignant beginnings, she reflects on what's so terribly wrong and yet so completely right about the church, long ago and today. Bethlehem epitomizes the contrasts and mysteries of the church she knows so well. This is what she says. The church grew so far almost at once from anything which can have been intended, and became so bloodstained and persecuting and cruel and warlike, and made small and trivial things so important, and tried to exclude everything not done in a certain way and by certain people, and stamped out heresies with such cruelty and rage. And this failure of the Christian church, of every branch of it in every country, is one of the saddest things that has happened in all the world. But it is what happens when a magnificent idea has to be worked out by human beings who do not understand much of it, but interpret it in their own way and think they are guided by God, whom they have not yet grasped. And yet they had grasped something. So the church has always had great magnificence and much courage, and people have died for it in agony, which is supposed to balance all the other people who have had to die in agony because they did not accept it. And it has flowered up in learning and culture and beauty and art to set against its incivility and obscurantism and barbarity and nonsense. And it has produced saints and martyrs and kindness and goodness, though these have also occurred freely outside it. And it is a wonderful and most extraordinary pageant of contradictions, and I at least want to be inside it, though it is foolishness to most of my friends. This is the mystery of the church, as described by someone who knows it as well as she knows herself, and loves it the way you long for something or someone unique that lingers just out of reach. What Laurie is saying is that the church has been one, but it's also been divisive. It's been holy, but it's also been sinful. It's been Catholic, but it's also been narrow. It's been apostolic, but it's also been forgetful. And yet, amid what she calls its wonderful and most extraordinary pageant of contradictions, she sees a place even for her, despite all her confusions and despair. The biggest difference between a problem and a mystery is not just that a problem can be solved while a mystery can't. It's that a problem is something you can walk away from, whereas a mystery becomes something that absorbs and engulfs you in such a way that your life depends on it. That's what the Towers of Trebizond is fundamentally about. One night, Laurie is troubled by a dream. In the dream, she's wrestling with whether she will finally be drawn into the kingdom of God or instead remain profoundly conflicted on the periphery. The fabled Black Sea port of Trebizond in northern Turkey becomes for her a vision of the New Jerusalem. She sees ethereal Trebizond and she imagines herself on the doorstep of heaven. This is what she says. Then, between sleeping and waking, there rose before me a vision of Trebizond, not Trebizond as I had seen it, but the Trebizond of the world's dreams, of my own dreams, shining towers and domes shimmering on a far horizon, yet close at hand, luminously enspelled in the most fantastic unreality, yet the only reality, a walled and gated city, magic and mystical, standing beyond my reach, yet I had to be inside. An alien wanderer, yet at home, held in the magical enchantment, and at its heart, at the secret heart of the city and the legend and the glory in which I was caught and held, there was some pattern that I could not unravel, some hard core that I could not make my own. And seeing the pattern and the hard core enshrined within the walls, I turned back from the city and stood outside it, expelled in mortal grief. By talking about the pattern that she can't unravel and the hard core that she can't make her own, Laurie seems to be echoing Gabriel Marcel's distinction between a problem and a mystery. If the church is a problem, Laurie is never going to solve it, but remain gloomily outside it looking for the solution. Yet the church isn't a problem. The church is a mystery. And as she says, it is magical and mystical, standing beyond my reach, yet I had to be inside, an alien wanderer yet at home, held in the magical enchantment. Is this you? Are you Laurie? Do you relate to these words? An alien wanderer yet at home, held in the magical enchantment. My experience as a pastor has taught me that most church-going Christians are rather more like Laurie than we generally care to admit. Our view of the church is stretched between our thrill at the magnificent idea and our horror at the incivility and obscurantism and barbarity and nonsense. And our view of ourselves is similarly stretched between our longing for certain answers and clear solutions to problems, and our recognition that, like Laurie, we are complex and compromised people, knee-deep in complicity with fallible commitments and flawed convictions. So how do we regard the church without lapsing into bitter cynicism or escaping into lofty idealism? How do we eagerly seek the church's renewal even while we know we can't fix it? Well, I suggest we translate the church's motto, One Holy Catholic Apostolic, into four questions. When faced with a new development, a change in leadership, a moral quandary, a pressing crisis, there are four questions to ask, four questions to make us one holy Catholic and apostolic. First, the unity question. Is our church making us one with one another? Second, the holiness question. Is our church making us one with God? Third, the Catholicity question. Is our church as gloriously diverse as God's world? And fourth, the apostolicity question. Would the first apostles recognize us? Almost every church is strong on one of these questions. One of the reasons the church is so divided is because various different parts of the church differ on which of these questions is the most important one. We all have our favorites, and we're all liable to focus on one to the exclusion of the others. But the truth is, they're all equally important. The difficult part is not saying yes to one of them, it's saying yes to all of them at the same time. How can you tell the Holy Spirit is at work in the church? This is how. When the people are drawing closer to one another, when they are being drawn closer to God, when the church is becoming as gloriously diverse as God's world, and when it is looking more and more like the early church, so the first apostles could immediately recognize it. That's what the Holy Spirit did at Pentecost. The Holy Spirit embraced the full diversity of humanity and made people one with one another and one with God. That's what the Holy Spirit does today. That's what the Holy Spirit alone does. That's what we're praying for when we call on the Holy Spirit. One holy, Catholic, apostolic. Never be persuaded that you have to choose one out of the four. Always seek all four together. One holy, Catholic, apostolic. It's a magnificent idea, and it's a pageant of contradictions. And in the power of the Holy Spirit, it's a mystery that once you enter it, will absorb your whole life.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, by your Spirit you have gathered us here today. We pray for those who have left and those who reject the church out of dismay, disappointment, and frustration over its failures to fulfill its mission. We pray for those for whom the pastor, the priest, or prophet is not honored because of abuse or misuse of the position, privilege, and power. Bless our loved ones and friends, O Lord, who don't believe in Jesus and the church. May they come to know you by our love for you and for one another, as well as for our enemies. We do give you praise for the full flavor and beautiful garden of diversity that constitutes the worldwide body of Christ. We thank you for all the gifts of the church and the diversity of faithful and life-giving expressions in our liturgy and lives. May your Spirit alight upon us, individually and collectively, that we may experience the unity, the wonder, and the elation of Pentecost. Lord, in your mercy, prayer. Compassionate God, look upon your people today with favor as we need your healing. Bless and keep our sick and shut in. We pray for families and children in Durham whose parents are incarcerated. Comfort and bless the parents and families of teenagers killed in fatal car accidents. Dry our weary eyes through the night. We give you thanks for the survivors of nearly fatal accidents and diseases such as cancer. We pause in silence for a cancer survivor and in memory of those who have passed away. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Holy Spirit, as the heat and humidity of summer rolls in, we pray for plenty of rain. We pray for wisdom to flow through us as we care for our bodies. May we cherish and nourish our neighbors as we do ourselves. Inspire us to share generously. Bless Urban Ministries, the Genesis Home, the Interfaith Hospitality Network, the Dove House and Phoenix House, Trosa, J. Roof Manor, and our own Pathways House this summer. Multiply the bread and stock of our city food banks and pantries. May our community gardens flourish and the relationships amongst our neighbors be full of joy and laughter as we gather in parks and pools and picnics and around our kitchen tables. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creating God, we give you thanks for the beauty of our planet, of your planet, O Lord. May those whose vocation is the upkeep, sustenance, preservation, and beautifying of your planet, we bless. We pray for those working diligently to clean up the massive oil leak in the Gulf of Mexico. As we pray for them, we pray for and bless our city waste management workers and our own Duke groundskeepers. Though they are often invisible to the general public and sometimes forgotten for the great work they do, we thank you for the fruits that we enjoy of their labors and that your hand will be upon them and is upon them continually. We bless and pray and esteem them highly for beautifying our campus and furthermore, cleaning up after our post-game, post-party, and post-graduation messes. Lord, we bring these and all our unspoken prayers, we lay them at your altar today because we love you, we trust you, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Now let us rejoice, for it is our time to give our fruits back to the Lord, the giver of every good and perfect gift. Amen.
you have come this morning with a heavy heart or a burden that you would like to receive prayer and anointing with oil, there will be ministers in the memorial chapel to my right during the sharing of communion, and they are ready to pray with you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, it is our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God, through Jesus' Son, Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. This day we give you thanks because in fulfillment of your promise, you pour out your Spirit upon us, with your gifts leading us into all truth, and uniting peoples of many tongues in the confession of one faith. Your Spirit gives us the grace to call you Father, to proclaim your gospel to all nations, and to serve you as a royal priesthood. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. As the grain once scattered in the fields and the grapes once dispersed on the hillside are now reunited on this table in bread and wine, so, Lord, may your whole church soon be gathered together from the corners of the earth into your kingdom, where all honor and glory are yours, now and forever. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power glory forever. We become one in the broken body of Christ. Come and find your peace in the mystery of this heavenly banquet.
Thank you.
you would please stand. Eternal God, you called your people from east and west and north and south to eat at the table of Jesus Christ. We thank you for Christ's presence and for the spiritual food of Christ's body and blood. By the power of your Holy Spirit, keep us faithful to your will. Go with us to the streets, to our homes, and to our places of labor and leisure, that whether we are gathered or scattered, we may be the servant church of the servant Christ, in whose name we rejoice and pray. Amen. This service is ended, but our life with him goes on and on. If you would go into the world in his name, may your light so shine and your joy be so obvious that all who see you will come to praise Christ. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.